Let's shine by seeing the best in all of us. And by looking out for each other. Let's stay healthy. Let's shine together.
Hi, I'm Sherry Harlan, program host for Let's Talk Together, and thanks for joining us today. And our guest today is Susan Ream, and she's with Reid Health. She's our nursing well-being specialist, and welcome. And today we are talking New Year's resolutions.
Yes.
And before we get into that, Susan, tell us how you came to Reid.
Well, I am entering into my 17th year at Reid. I originally came from a community mental health center and took a position in outpatient behavioral health as a therapist. And in that time, I got to work on the inpatient psychiatric unit and then work as an employee assistance counselor within the organization for Reid staff. Went back to inpatient psychiatry as the director of the inpatient units, both the geriatric and the adult units. And most recently have been blessed to have an opportunity to focus on the emotional well-being of the Reid teams within the inpatient tower. Post-COVID, we saw that this is an area that staff could utilize some additional support besides EAP and various resources. So I am currently a well-being specialist for the nursing teams.
Oh, great. And also, one of the things that I know you bring, you have a wagon that you take around for staff and other guests. Can you share with us about what's in that wonderful wagon that you carry around?
Well, it's kind of silly, but it's true. I have a very noisy, squeaky wagon. And I tried around on the inpatient tower. Oftentimes staff become so busy it's hard to get a lunch or to take a cognitive break from patient care. So I stock my wagon with fruits, granola bars, some water flavorings, candy obviously, you can't go without candy, trail mix, things like that. And then I tread around on the inpatient hospital just to check in emotionally on how the staff are doing and the teams are doing. It affords me an opportunity to check in if there's a code. I'm able to stick around and debrief with the team members and just kind of process where they're feeling emotionally and offer some debriefings in the moment when situations can become very tense. So the wagon is my doorway in to talk with staff, and then I have the ability just to follow up and circle back around at a later time just to make sure everybody's doing okay.
Well, I'd like to add, when people see Susan in her wagon, it's always a smile.
Yes, I'm like the ice cream truck. The squeaky wheel is the replacement for the music, I guess. But thank you for bringing that up.
Great. So today we're going to talk about New Year's resolutions. And that's always just a wide variety of New Year's resolutions and different people, how they utilize a New Year's resolution.
Well, I'll tell you, not to interrupt, New Year's resolutions, many people are optimistic coming into a new year, and it's like having a clean slate. And many of us experience the exact same challenges when we make a New Year's resolution or multiple ones. And so I appreciate the ability to talk on this a little bit to see about different pitfalls that we run into and ways to mitigate that.
How many people decide to have a New Year's resolution?
Well, I can tell you probably close to 100% want to have a resolution, but about 62% of the population do not make a resolution because they've failed at previous attempts. So they don't want to set themselves up for failure, so it's better just not to commit on it. Of the 38.5% of the population that do make a New Year's resolution, 52.6% establish one goal in their resolution, and the remaining 47.4% establish multiple goals. One of the challenges of that is when you set up multiple goals, it's hard to be compliant. You kind of set the bar super duper high, and it's like making this all or nothing. I either pass or fail. And if I had one meal where I didn't eat well, then I consider failure, so I might as well just eat how I want the rest of the day. So there are challenges associated with New Year's resolution. So my hope is at the end of the program, there'll be a way to do this that you feel more confident.
Right. Now, what are some of the common resolutions?
Well, I think most of us can attest to having this as a goal at some point. Exercising more. Eating healthier, losing weight, saving money, pursuing career or additional educational training, spending less time on social media. I know that's one of my pitfalls. That's kind of my relaxation. But there's good and bad on social media. So just being aware of your mentality, getting on it, cutting down on drinking, spending more time with our loved ones, and giving up smoking. Most of us can relate to a majority of these goals.
Now, when you were saying one of the things that establishing multiple goals as opposed to one goal, I can see both the good and bad on both. Because I would say, okay, I want to exercise more and I want to lose weight and I want to eat healthier. And I want to save money.
Right.
So if I put everything down, so when I start to drop off.
It's like changing the whole you.
Right.
You know, and if you can pinpoint one goal that may have a multiple ripple effect, that's the goal you want to target because there's therapeutic benefit that goes across the board. If I eat healthier, chances are my metabolism's going to pick up. I'm going to be more energized to perform exercise. I'll be more prone to park farther out in the parking lot to get those additional steps. There is a ripple effect, but when I'm so concrete and I set a goal that I want to lose 100 pounds in 2 weeks, and all these steps that go along with it, I'm setting myself up for failure.
Right.
Yes.
When often the biggest thing is, and I know how people, the workout centers like a Planet Fitness or the Y's, like that first week. Usually the first couple of weeks in January, they're very crowded.
Very much so.
And then they drop off.
Yes.
So is that a testament to, as people just drop off, their bandwagon is moves away?
I think what happens is we're not very forgiving of ourselves.
Okay.
About 9% of the population actually maintains their New Year's resolution until the very end of the year. What people don't recognize is that about 25% quit their resolution in the first week because it's so counter to their daily behavior that it's just too much work. 43% in their resolution by the end of February. And then ultimately, of 62 who do not establish a resolution, many report because they failed their resolution so many times. Where if we go into this with a forgiving mentality, okay, I dropped the ball today, tomorrow's a new day. I dropped the ball this meal, but the next meal I have the ability to step back in and make it right. It's that all or nothing mentality and being forgiving of yourself, that we're all human, and we'll talk a little bit more on other slides about why the 9% succeed. So,
so what's the high degree of the failure for the resolutions?
9% are the ones that make it. So that leaves 91% right. That's bombing it and just give up. And it goes back to not forgiving ourselves. Okay, it was just too much. I'm tired. I'm not going to do it anymore. So.
And when you were saying just more on the positive side, so many times everybody, well, I know I do. So I think of all the things that I'm giving up.
Mm-hmm.
I want my donut.
Yep.
But I know that that's too much sugar,
yep.
And that's not going to help me be healthier.
Yep.
So what can you suggest, like the positive side?
For sure. So, I mean, the failure rate relates back to setting these goals that are unrealistic. For me to sit here and say, you should never, ever, 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 ever have a donut again. What's going to happen is you're going to fixate on that donut and have some anger and resentment that there's quality of life and there's quantity of life. We need to find the balance between the two. Oftentimes, my goals may be too vague. Well, I'm going to lose weight. Well, what does that mean? I can lose a pound and I met my goal for the year, or I need to be more concrete. I have too many goals that are too different to the lifestyle that I currently lead. My goal focuses on the negative. For example, I'm going to quit smoking. Research has found some people can do cold turkey and it works for them. Other people respond better to having a titration plan because it's so ingrained in my day-to-day behavior that if I take it away completely, my body's more prone to have a temper tantrum. So the more I can titrate and reduce that behavior over a period of time, the more likely I'm going to be successful. The goal's not meaningful to the person. A perfect example of this is that I'm diabetic. Say I'm diabetic and my family wants me to take better care of my eating, but I'm going to make that commitment because I love my family and I don't want to disappoint them. But it's really not intrinsically motivating to me. So setting a goal that holds importance to you personally and not do it because somebody else is doing it.
It has to be your goal.
For sure. And we can wish, will, and pray all we want. And the reality is all of us would be different people if I could wish, will, and pray it away. Not that prayer can't help, but we have to have the internal drive in order to alter our behaviors ultimately. And then probably the biggest thing is not completing a year-end evaluation of what went well this year and what can I improve on, and in utilizing your past year's experience in creating a new resolution for the next year. So looking at the information that you have and how you feel about what was successful and what was not, and then creating your goals based on what you feel like needs to be changed.
And I can see that where the year, the success and failures is personal.
Yes.
And someone else looking at you could see something completely different. Like, you had the best year ever.
For sure.
When personally you're thinking, this was the worst year of my life.
Absolutely. So. Absolutely. And we let people see what we want them to see. And it's that internal dialogue that you have with yourself that absolutely contributes to your success or failure. Like I said, that we tend to hold ourselves to a much higher standard than we would hold other people to. And that inherently can set us up for failure, for sure.
So let's talk about positive thinking and well-being.
For sure. Can absolutely do that. A depressed brain overall will tend to gravitate towards things in the environment that reinforces the world's depressing. The same happens with a positive, optimistic brain. It seeks out the things that affirm what's right in the world and what could be improved on. And so, you know, what we're trying to do is retrain our brain to not be so mean to ourselves and be forgiving and recognizing that every new moment is a new moment to start fresh. What most people don't realize, for those 9% that succeeded in their resolution, they fell off the wagon 14 times.
Wow.
And But what we see is just the success at the end of it,
right,
that we were able to incorporate in a new behavior. And so it's that awareness. And I don't want people to be like, well, here's number 12, I fell off. You know, and when I get to 14, it's all over. That's not the case. We need to be forgiving of ourselves as we try to alter our behaviors.
Now, on a different note, I have two neighbors that both have lost 100 pounds.
Wow.
However, when I'm driving past them coming to work, they're walking. And so I can't complain because I haven't been walking like they are. So.
Right. Well, and it's amazing, just a random sidebar fact, you know, exercise, if I incorporate exercise into my day, research has found about 150 minutes worth of exercise every day releases the same amount of serotonin as a Prozac pill.
Wow.
So even parking farther out in the parking lot and getting those extra steps, there's therapeutic benefit. But I'm not going to make a big deal because I parked two more spots down. I need to celebrate my small successes,
right,
and recognize that I'm altering my behavioral pattern so that it's not this all or nothing. I do this and I have to do this all the time. It's a gradual change that feels less intrusive in my life.
And let's talk about the end of the year reflections.
Yeah. What in terms of some basic questions that I would encourage people to consider when they're doing their New Year's resolutions is to have a moment to yourself where, what were the challenges I experienced in 2023? What were the relationships involved with the challenges? It's not, oftentimes challenges aren't just, you know, my taxes were messed up. Usually there's some things that happened that led up to that outcome. So what were the relationships that were involved that either improved it or maybe made the situation more difficult? What were the behaviors that I experienced when I saw the failure or felt like there was a failure? And then what actions did I take to mitigate that? Did I just continue to complain about it and do the poor Susan, that's a terrible thing that happened, or am I going to make purpose out of that experience to create something new based on the challenges I experienced and what are the speed bumps I had? And then alternate of that, what were the things in 2023 that were absolutely precious to you that, oh, I want to replicate that if I can, and I want to set up the environment similar so I can experience that again, again, going back to what were the relationships involved with that? You talk about your neighbors that lost 100 pounds. It sounds like they've developed a relationship with one another where they can support each other in their goals, and there's intrinsic reward because now I have a friend that is marching the same battle as me and setting up an environment that nurtures that relationship.
So they're walking while I'm waving at them.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely.
The another part of that, the whole end of the year reflection, just to highlight that you can't concentrate on the bad things.
You can't. Have you ever had the job evaluation where, like 99.999% of your evaluation was absolutely wonderful, and then what to improve on? You have maybe one or two on there of things that are meant to be supportive, mentoring, things like that you can improve on, whatever it is, and you fixate on that one or two thing and lose 99.9% of all the wonderful that you're doing. It's altering the mentality to have more of an open perspective that, okay, that's good feedback. It's not criticism. It's to mentor me to be more successful in whatever I'm doing. And just being aware of that use that as a launching pad of, okay, what are some steps that I could do to improve in this area, rather than focus on that and then lose sight of all the wonderful stuff that you're doing.
So almost like a garden.
Absolutely.
That you had a little some bugs got into one part of the garden.
Yeah.
But you were able to feed 300 people.
Absolutely. So. Absolutely. That's a perfect example.
So what should we do before we create a resolution?
Well, when you're doing your resolutions, what you want to do is look at patterns. And several of us kind of go into patterns where we fixate on the things that didn't go well. And you want to prioritize what you want to do and how you want to do it. Again, we don't want to fixate on the negative. What we want to do is improve. You know, nobody's perfect. Nobody's perfect. And we want to support one another. So in reviewing it, was there a pattern of behavior? I'm going to use the smoking example.
Okay.
Was there a pattern of behavior that after I talked to my sister, after I got off the phone with my sister, I immediately light up a cigarette because that's a source of stress for me. And then, or after I eat, I light up a cigarette. It's recognizing that there are certain patterns, and if I'm going to establish a resolution specific to that, then I need to find acceptable behaviors to replace that pattern. And so that's why the year in review is so important, because I'm going to want to replace as much positive stuff right. with the negative. So I associate my conversation with my sister, maybe, I don't know, maybe I'm going to donate an item to the food bank in my sister's name. Or I know people are like, that's kind of a weird analogy. Not really, because you feel like you're giving back.
Right, right.
I didn't give well to this over here, so I'm going to find a way to give back where there's going to be a ripple effect. And you'll want to change your patterns. We don't, again, where we experience failure is when we change our patterns so dramatically all at once. The brain has neural pathways that are deeply, deeply embedded over years and years of behavior. Just because I want to lose weight, you know, I can wish will, I want to lose weight, but I haven't changed the neural pathway to alter that process, if that makes any sense.
It's kind of like I've seen people that come in and like, I'm getting rid of all the sugar in the house.
Yes.
This.
Yes.
And then they're mad.
Yes. And angry because
right.
I went all this time doing things in a way that, doggone it, what can I use to celebrate now?
Right.
I want a bowl of sugar. I want a donut. I want something. So we need to incorporate rewards in with things at some point that may utilize some of those things as long as we're in control of it.
So when we're setting the goals for ourselves, mm-hmm. what would you recommend?
Well, I can tell you that it's important to do SMART goals.
Okay.
And SMART goals are S stands for specific. What exactly do I want to accomplish? I want to lose 30 pounds, okay? Measurable. It needs to be something concrete and non-negotiable. I am the gal that can negotiate anything if it's vague enough, right?
Correct.
When I'm vulnerable, I'm going to look for every opportunity to negotiate whatever. So measurable, maybe I want to lose 30 pounds over the next 12 months. A stands for achievable. Is it something that's achievable? Going back to the example, I want to lose 100 pounds in 2 weeks. Not a realistic goal. And not one. So I'm setting myself up for failure before I start. And I'm already going to be angry because there's no chance of a donut.
Right.
If I get, I got to do
yes.
Achievable goals. Relevant. Again, that goes back to the conversation of, is it important to me? I know that Dr. Reichle would like me to lose some weight and maybe 100 pounds. Is it relevant? I'm not really motivated to lose 100 pounds. I'm okay. I need to lose 30. And I want to make sure it's relevant to what I want to do. And then ultimately, T stands for time frame. You need a specific and measurable time frame to meet these goals. One thing that I would encourage in a SMART goal is have steps to steps to success. Make them small. My first goal to lose 30 pounds, maybe my goal is to lose 2 pounds in the first month. And then I need to have a small way to celebrate that success. Maybe it's going and buying a new pair of pants. Maybe it's going to the movies and having that special dessert that I haven't been able to have. But it's setting up small steps to success to measure your achievements.
Now, what's some of the supports and some resources that people can look into?
Great. So relationships and their emotional impact is very, very important. You need to invest in terms of your spirituality, and maybe there's people within the community through your church or through, you know, your congregation that you emotionally connect to that can be supportive of you. It's very important to be aware of your sleep cycle. Your sleep cycle is probably the biggest predictor of your well-being. If I'm not getting enough sleep, then I'm running on adrenaline to try to get through the day, and it's janking up probably my blood sugars. If I'm getting too much sleep, then my motivation to get out of bed and to do the things that I need to do for self-care gets compromised too. Not everybody needs 8 hours of sleep. Some people can function on 4 hours of sleep as long as it's the deep sleep, but making sure that you're doing that. If you're trying to lose weight, I'm going to ask you to cognitively reframe it and be where I'm changing my nutrition. I'm not dieting. Dieting has a connotation that it's going to be a short-term, temporary period of time where I'm changing my nutrition. That is a much longer lifespan type of thing. And in terms of resources, there are lots of resources in the community related to this. And, you know, I mentioned also, you know, exercise and the 150 minutes. Some people that have been exercising their whole life may need to do more.
And as we're coming to a close, I know we have a slide on a lot. There's a lot of smart apps
yes.
that we can go to.
Yes.
There's. And so we'll have that.
Wonderful.
We're going to list that here.
Wonderful.
And we want to thank you for joining us today, Susan.
Thank you so much for the
and
opportunity.
And hopefully everyone learns a lot.
I hope so.
And to use these resources for their New Year's resolutions. And thank you for joining us on Let's Talk Together.
Let's shine by seeing the best in all of us and by treating you here, right in your hometown. Let's look out for each other. Let's stay healthy. Let's shine together.